much to us today, because in our reading our Bible, we need to not just try to be concerned about how much we have read. We need to be concerned about how much we have understood that we have read. And can we read it in its context? What is it talking about? He is talking to you. When you open up this Bible, don't read it as statements to remember and statements to just echo, but read this Bible as an instruction to your life. And it tells you don't give place to the devil. The next thing you need to start understanding, what does the devil do? How can I give place to the devil? What is the devil's operation? What does he do? One thing about the devil, the Bible says he's an accuser of the brethren. So if you start to become an accuser based on something that appears a certain way to you, you are giving place to the devil. If you accuse your wife because you ride down the road and she happened to look over the car that stopped and you think she was lusting at the man and you're not sure, you are accuser of the brethren. You're giving place to the devil. And it's no telling how far that can go. The Bible tells us to judge nothing before the time and to the Lord reveal and make manifest the hidden things of dishonesty. When you make your way to the devil, what was the devil? What was the anatomy of Satan? What was he made out of? What was he built up of? What created him to be the devil? He wasn't a devil in the beginning. He was Lucifer. And which meant a bright shining star and precious in the sight of God. How did he turn to become the devil? How did he become a devil? How did he become Satan? The word Satan means prosecuting a false accuser. Devil means prosecutor, come from the word diabolos, which means prosecutor, accuser. How did he become that? Number one, pride was his biggest fall. And we got to understand those same things can enter into our hearts and we're giving place to him. What was his pride? He said was in his heart, I will ascend, I will exalt myself above the stars. I will be like the Most High. Now, when you get in your mind, you want to exalt yourself and not God to exalt you. How does God exalt you and how you exalt yourself? You exalt yourself by domineeringness and pushing your weight around. And by demanding, by aggression, by words. But how does God exalt you? God said, he that humbles himself shall be exalted. Are you seeking the way God exalts you? Are you seeking the way you feel you ought to exalt yourself? God said, if your enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. And so doing, you'll heap coals of fire upon his head. God's method of winning warfare is not, you shoot my dog, I kill your cat. But if you shot my dog, I invite you over to dinner and pick cook you a good old barbecue. It is only faith in God when you can respond in this manner, which we all will be tested. So you don't give place to the devil. Don't allow him to put thoughts in your heart. How did the devil do in heaven? How was he so successful in causing a third of the heavenly host to be cast down? Did you know you in church? And I guess I want to read that, but I want to go down and read a little bit here so I can really talk about that devil a little more. We're going to go to Ephesians chapter 5 in verse number 7 in chapter 5. It said, be not therefore partakers with them, for you sometime was in dark, but now you're light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Now he's telling you not to be partakers with people that are living in sinful lives. And you recognize things they're doing are not right. You recognize how they talk to their wife, how they fight, how they talk to their husband. And you sit right there just to be a buddy. You go along with it and be a partaker with it. He said, be not partaker with them. I wish I had time to talk to you about that, but I'm going over to verse 14. It said, wherefore, he said, awake thou that sleepeth and arise from the dead, and Christ will give thee light. He's telling you to wake up, you that's sleeping. When he's using the term sleeping, he's not talking about you sitting up in church and you snoring. He's telling you, you're not aware. Sleeping means you, somebody can come right around you and still take your wallet. You never know it. When you're so sleep in a deep sleep, you don't know what's going on. You know, a deep sleep was put up on Adam, and God went in there and created an operation on him, broke his ribs up, and he never knew it till he got up. Because a deep sleep was on him. Here is the Bible telling us as Christian people, wake up. Wake yourself up. Be alert. Be aware of what's going on. Now, we must, as people of God, we got to start taking these scriptures literally and what they're instructing us. This is what gives us the security of defense. Is when we respond to what God instructed us to be aware. It is the child that goes and follows his parents' instructions in school, of friends to associate with, and of things to engage in, and this hours of study. It's that child, that one that escapes the violence that tends to swallow up those that are not instructed. So God is instructing his children in these scriptures here. First, he tells us, be not partakers with folks that are doing wrong. Then he tells us to wake up if we're sleeping and don't know what's going on around us. Then he said, arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you light. When you say arise, that's a self-effort. You might be looking for God to lift you out of something. That's not rise. That means God's going to pull you out. No, you got to arise. You got to get yourself out of things that's contradicting God's word. When you arise, that's your own self saying, this is enough for this. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm going to rise up. Rise, he said, and God will give you light. Then he says, see that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. And it's things when I read these scriptures like this that makes me abhor these modern translations, because they take this and they don't want to write walk circumspect. And I read through two or three of them, and they'll have be careful. Circumspect and careful, though they are synonyms, are two different words with two different meanings. Careful suggests that you're aware of what you're doing in a cautious, in a caring manner. You can be careful in how you hold a baby. You're not circumspect in holding a baby. You're careful in holding a baby. You might be careful how you speak when you are brought before your supervisor. You're watching things you're saying, making sure you don't set something out of order or said the right things. That's careful, but that's not circumspect. So when you read these Bibles and they twist these words up to this modern junk, it's filthy in my sight, because it takes away the effect of what God intends for his people to know. Combines the word circum, which means around. Circumcised means to cut around. Circumnavigate means to sail around. Circumspect combines the word, the Latin word specere, which means to look on. We get the word from the word specere, we get the word spectator. One who looks on. So, but when you got circum in the front of it, if you put spectator, it means one who looks on around. So you got to not just use that as careful, but the word specere really means looking on with wariness. These concerns of consequences, unforeseen danger. That's what circumspect means. It means you can't say careful, and neither can you say cautious. Careful just simply means you are concerned about what you're doing or how you're carrying out something. You're making sure it's done tender or whatever. Cautious mean like you're crossing the street. You're cautious in crossing the street. You're cautious of danger. You walk up to a house and you see dog, cautious. You start looking for a dog in that area. That's cautious. Though these are synonyms of circumspect, but they give a different connotation. Circumspect means a wary cautiousness, a grave concern of thoughts that you, of decisions and judgments, concerning all of the things that are about you, their consequences, an unforeseen outlook. So here's the writer telling us that we should walk with the concern so deeply that we recognize wrong steps could lead to disaster. And he got the word circum there, which means in everything around us, we need to know about it. We need to know about our children. We need to know about their friends. We can't have a wife or a husband that's private and do stuff we don't know what they're doing. You got to be circumspect, brother. You can't just take a kiss and that's good enough. I want to know where you're going. I want to know why I can't travel with you. That's what I want to know. Why you want to get a, I got to be circumspect. Hallelujah. God called his preachers and one time said it was dumb dogs just loving the slumber. Some of us, all we need is some chicken and a television and we'll go to sleep and don't care what else going. Feed you a good old steak and you go to bed so hard you don't know where the children are, where the wife is, what's going on. Hallelujah. So we ought to be circumspect. Inquire into your bank accounts. Know where your money is being spent. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Know the people you engage with. Know the ones you allow in your circle. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He says, see that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. As you walk in this time, why should we be that? Redeeming the time. When we read these things in the Bible, let us consider the time we're living in. When you go to the store, ladies, don't walk out the store so excited of the new necklace you just bought. You just looking at it and you walk into your car and here come the man come up behind you and beat you upside the head and you're dead. Watch where you park. Bishop, you're teaching fear. No, I'm teaching you to be circumspect. And circumspect itself connotates wariness. Because the evil, violent man lurks and looks for the individual that is unaware. They have come up and talked about that when you got lights in your around your house or cameras, you can many times prevent burglaries. Because the old bandit, he just wants every opportunity to be advantageous, that he's certain just the fact that you look him out of eye may deter some attack. Hallelujah. 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 I got to teach you this. When you park your car, know what you're parking up against. See if there's a group of men inside of a van sitting in there on a parking lot. Get, I don't care if the parking is close to the front. Get out of that car, park somewhere else. Be what? Why? Why he said that? Redeeming the time? Because the days are evil. Then when he speaks in terms of redeeming the time, what does it mean, redeem? Rescue. Redeem was a term used in Old Testament times when God had told all of Israel to give their firstling of all of their increase. If a man had a calf, he had cattle, the first cow, the first bull was given to God. The first son was given to God. The first everything they had. But a son or something very valuable, you could redeem it. That means you could pay the money and you could double in price of its value. And you could keep it, you would redeem it, you would pay for it. You would actually not suffer loss of something that was valuable to you. Here is God saying, redeem the time. Now, he's trying to let us know time is valuable. The time we are in this church today, we will see it no more. Once this time leave you, it's gone. You can't get it back. It's gone. When you spend time at a computer playing games, that time is lost. He's telling you to look at your time and what are you putting your time into? The Bible said to everything and every purpose under the sun, there's a time and a season for everything under the sun. It's a time to be born. It's a time to die. God has said, I'm going to reward you according to your works. You fixing to die now and you trying to get saved. And you ain't did nothing but acted a clown all your life. And God said, I'm going to reward you according as your works shall be. Now here you are in the hospital, you call for the preacher, and in the time when you could have done something, in the time you could have given yourself to God, you paid no attention. You did not redeem the time. You didn't redeem the time. Oh, hold that breath. Let me go to something here. Hallelujah. Matthew's Gospel chapter 25. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. This is verse 1, 25 Matthew. And five of them were wise and five were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. Now listen at that. They took a lamp, but no oil. That's like people sitting in church. And the word anointed really comes from the word unctuous, which really means anointing or oil, which really means oil or slippy or power. They had no oil, meaning they had no spirit. But they looked and had a lamp there for show, but they took no oil in their vessels with their lamps. Let's read this. A lot of people, now these virgins, we know they lied when the bridegroom came and said their lamps had gone out. But when you start to read it, you see they never had oil. That means they can sit right beside you and never do the things your preacher's telling you to do. That people ain't paid tithes since they've been here. That people, they'll sit right there and shout and dance and look over everything. Are you thinking they're trying to be perfect in what God said? No, they omit that. But they'll walk right beside you, shout as hard as you, dance like you dance. The five was wise, five were foolish. They that were foolish, verse 4, took their lamps and took no oil with them. Now see, now I know a lot of people believe those lying virgins when they said their oil went out and they'll go preaching, you know, the church is all going out. No, these people never had no light. There are some people never overcome their temper. There are some people never get bitterness out of their heart and cussing out their mouth. I'm telling you right now, I see them. They never get selfish and self-centeredness out of them. They shout. They can pray for hours and still never change because they don't want to repent of their personalities. They don't want to humble themselves before God. But they went the wise virgins walking in the wise virgin light. They sat in the cushioned pews that the wise virgin pledges and pay tithes for. They utilize the air condition and the building and the facility that the wise virgin sacrifice and see that it continues on. And they sit right there in the light and enjoy and suck up everything and do nothing themselves. They are foolish. They'll see people do good, and they can always attract to a soft person because a soft person doesn't reject them and rebuke them for their wrong. But you better be careful about some aggressive person always attracted to you, because sometimes you don't be surprised they'll mess over you and cause you to be a partaker of their evil deeds. Paul said it in Thessalonians. He said, withdraw yourself from every brother that walks disorderly and not according to the tradition you've heard of me. You, it's upon you to rise. You got to make sure of your friends. I don't care if it's a sister or brother. You don't join with a sister or brother to go break in a house. You don't join with a sister or brother to come together to backbite or to be critical of people in church or outside of church. You ought to withdraw yourself. Though they make you cookies and candy. I want you to hold that right there. I'm mad at the devil anyhow. I'm going over here to the book of Genesis. Hallelujah. Are you with me today? In Genesis chapter 12, and it says, now the Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house and to a land that I will show thee, and I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Every one of us should be a blessing as well as we want to be blessed. When God gets through with your life, you should be a blessing to others when they're around you. But what you have, he told Abraham, get away from your kindred and your father's house. Meaning why? Abraham's father named Terah served idol gods. They sacrificed unto idol gods. Abraham, that's why you hear nothing about Abraham's father other than he started on his way to Canaan, but he never made it there. But God intended, saw his son. Terah perhaps was one, tried to serve all the gods of the land. Which some people try to satisfy everybody.